Welcome everyone to today's program. My name is Rhonda Hoffman. I'm the genealogy specialist at the Buffalo and Erie County Public Library. I work in a place called the Grosvenor Room, where we have our genealogy, local history, maps, rare books, and music scores. The Grosvenor Room is open the same hours as the rest of the library. The only time that you'd need to make an appointment is if you wanted to view a rare book, and that would be noted in our catalog if something was a rare book. I do like to tell people that we do have different policies than the rest of the library. For example, we have you put any sort of bags, purses, and lockers, and we don't allow food or drink for the protection of our unique materials. So today's class is finding and navigating probate records, Western New York probate records in Family Search. So here we are at the Family Search homepage. And I usually use this method. There's a couple of methods to get to the records. And the first one that I'll show you is to use the search menu and click records. So at the top of the page, we see search historical records. And then if you go down to find a collection, type in New York probate, and you'll get a few different entries. We're focusing on Western New York, which are in this top listing, New York probate record 1629 to 1971. But you can see that there are some other areas downstate as well. So if I click on the New York probate records, then you can see that the record set name near the top. And this is a set that is not indexed. I should say it's not keyword searchable. There are some indexes available with the scanned records, but these are not keyword searchable yet. So what you will do is click Browse All. And then you'll see a list of the county names. And all of the Western New York counties are in here. So you can see Allegheny, Cattaraugus, Chautauqua, Genesee, Erie. If everyone could stay muted, let's see here. And there's also Wyoming and Orleans. They're in alphabetical order, obviously. We're going to start with Erie County. So if we go and select Erie County, the first thing that you want to do is just peruse to see what's here. And usually you want to make a beeline for the estate indexes or any kind of index. It might be called a general index, but look for the different indexes that might be available. You can see for Erie County, there's a number of indexes for 1800 to 1929, grouped together by alphabetical groupings. And then we see a number of estate papers, and there's lots of them. What's available in these different New York probate records is different for each county. So we're going to see a few different examples. So I'm going to start with my estate index, and I'm going to look for a gentleman named Christian Abt. And so I'm going to look for the A to B index. And oftentimes what I'll do is I'll click this icon here, browse multiple images, where it will show me the thumbnails. And I like to skip ahead just those beginning pages of the microfilm. And what you want to look for first is to see if there's something called a tabular index. There's different companies that would put these indexes together. And this is a Graves tabular key index. And this will tell you what page to look on for the surname that you're looking for in these records. So I'm looking for the surname ABT. So here's A. The next thing you do is look down the left-hand side for B. You can see there's a few different entries for B. And then you want to go across for the next letter. So here's B and I'm looking for T. So here's the T. And the page number that I'm going to look for in this index book is page number 4. So I'm just going to file through, forward through to get to page 4. In these books, especially for larger those with larger population groups, you might see that there will be multiple pages of the same page number. So like here's page 1. There's another page 1. It keeps the same page number for those groupings that we looked at in the tabular index. So now I'm at the right page. I'm at page number 4. And you just want to look down the list. These aren't in exact alphabetical order. They're in those groupings according to the tabular index. But once you're to the right section, they're generally in date order. So if you know when your person passed away, you can start looking for the right section. And I was looking for this gentleman, Christian Abt. And what I want for Erie County is I want the case number right here. And this is how Erie County does it. They group all of their, all or most of their documents in these case files. So I would write down that case number 4. And then if I go back to Erie, I can then see all of those different listings. And I want to find the grouping of estate papers and the case numbers. So here you can see case 1 through 32 and mine is case 4. So that's where I'm going to look. And again, I like to go to this icon here, browse multiple images. For these case files, they will have a cover sheet. This is actually the outside of the envelope. If you were to ever go to the Erie County surrogate office, that's where you would go if you wanted to see these records in person. They'll come in these packets. They'll be folded up in these sort of dark files. And these are you can find the different sort of dividers between the different case files by looking for a dark image like this. For some of the years, you might see the case file number clearly written on the outside, but some of them, they're so dark, you can't read them. But you know it's the fourth one because this has case 1 through 32. And so you can just count 1, 2, 3, 4. So this should be the case file that we're looking for. And I kind of like to just look ahead and see how many pages are in this case file. And this is going to be a collection of all different types of documents associated with this file. You can see there's quite a few before we get to the next one right here. And you can just start by clicking on the first document. This is something you would see in an estate. You can see this is a maker of furniture, and it says there is an undertaking specialty. So, I'm wondering if this could be a receipt for perhaps a coffin. It's a little hard to read this handwriting. And, as you move through in the beginning of this file, and the files will be grouped together differently, there's all kinds of receipts. Let me just jump ahead one. So here you can see, here's a receipt. So as part of the process, the deceased's bills would be paid off from his estate. So we'll often see these different receipts. And it's kind of neat too, if your ancestor happens to be associated with this J.A. Bliss business, you can see their stationery. So that's kind of cool. Sometimes you'll see their different trademarks. And it's interesting to look these individuals up to see what types of products or services they might have purchased. And this individual, I looked, J.A. Bliss, they were a manufacturer of shingles. So I'm guessing he did some improvements to his house, or maybe he had built a new house recently. I'm just going to jump around within the images. You might see some more little tiny receipts. A lot of times you'll see these informal receipts in the account. This is a receipt from a Peter Gassner, and he was a blacksmith. And as you look through the records, one of the kind of documents that I always make a beeline for would be a petition for probate or a petition to for the will. I'm going to jump ahead. This is where you have a lot of those great family relationships that we're looking for. So you can see the name of the document at the top, petition for probate of a will. So that means there was a will. He did have a will. If it just said petition for probate, oftentimes that would mean that there was no will. And someone will make a petition to move forward with the estate. And here we have an Elizabeth Abt, and it says she's from the town of Amherst. And it says that Christian, who also lived in Amherst, that he died in the town of Amherst about 20th day of February, 1878. So this is great information that you find, because this is before the state required the keeping of vital records. So the probate records are a great source of information. We've got the place he died, and we've got the date of his death. And then these petitions will list the heirs. And oftentimes they'll list the individual's names and their relationship to the deceased, their age, and where they lived. So here we see his widow, that Elizabeth was his widow. And then we've got a daughter, which it seems like a married name here, Lorenz. And then we've got a number of other individuals, another daughter who's got a different surname, so that can link her to her married name. And we have some young children as well. And this, the probate records are great because you can also find people who moved around. So if people moved out of state and you don't know what happened to them, the estate files will list, if they are an heir, it will list where they're living at the time that they were settling the estate. Jumping ahead. Here we can see these are some different debts that were paid off from the estate. So again, you could look up these names. You can see how much was paid and do the conversions just to see what their bills were like. Here's a number of items that were sold, and it tells what they are, how much they were valued at, and then how much they were sold for. So you can see some wood and some grain, chickens. And then if we jump ahead a little bit further, here's an estate inventory. So things like furniture, wood rack, grindstone, old wagon, swine, horses. So you can look through and what he had in his estate. And then jumping a little bit more ahead, this document tells specifically what the family members received from that estate inventory. It doesn't get specific. It just says for his widow and children, all of those different things that we watched, that we saw on the last list. So I'm going to move on to show you a different county example. And to navigate to another county, you can click where it says New York Probate Records. And I'm going to go to Cattaraugus County. So you can see different types of records here. And I'm not seeing any kind of case files like we did. We saw lots of those for Erie County. But I do see a general index. So I'm interested in this time frame, 1800 to 1893. Some of these, different counties had different types of indexing. And for Cattaraugus County, they don't have a graves tabular index. How theirs are organized are in alphabetical groupings. So you can see names that started with AA would be listed here. Those started with AB are listed here. And so on and so on. I'm looking for the last name Williams, so I'm going to jump ahead. And you can just keep guessing just kind of keep picking a number and jumping ahead until you get to the right section. So here's the WIs. And I wanted to draw your attention to all of these different headings. In Erie County, we were interested in that case number. And Cattaraugus County has something similar, which is a box number. So those packets of information for each individual are put in boxes. And then there's a number of other types of documents here. And you can see different notations. They might give a volume and a page number. We're going to be looking at guardianship records in a little bit. But you can see there's different documents. Certain files had certain things and certain other files didn't necessarily have all of these documents. So again, these aren't in exact alphabetical order. I'm looking for the name Lucian Williams. So here's Lucian Williams. There is a box number. And that's often when you see these boxes or case files, that's often where you get the best information. So Cattaraugus County, these boxes aren't put on Family Search. You're going to want to seek these boxes out. You're going to want to go to the Cattaraugus County and go to their surrogate office, and you're going to want to look at what's in that box. It can be a little hard to look through these because it is a two-page spread. So I'll often kind of go up like this towards the top of my line, and just kind of navigate across to see where there are entries for these other types of documents. And one of them is right here. This is a volume 9, page 20 and 21. And if we scroll up towards the top, it's guardianship records. So then I want to see our guardianship records on here, and I'll go back to Cattaraugus. And there are. So what I want to do is I want to look for volume 9. And here's volume 9 and 10. And I'm going to just jump ahead. Let's see here. So here's pages 20 and 21, which were cited. And this is information about guardianships. And the person who died was Lucian Williams, but this was his son. He had a son named Lucian Williams. And he was underage. He was a minor when his father passed away. So a guardian was appointed for his young children. And what those guardians do is it's not someone who takes care of the child, like takes them in and takes care of them. But it, what those guardians do is they look after their interest in their father's or whoever's estate that passed away. But you can find some good information here. Oftentimes these, when the children do become of age, then it will usually give that information. So this tells us that Lucian Williams, that he lives in Red House in Cattaraugus County, and he arrived at the full age of 21 years old on the 10th day of June, 1893. So that's great information. This is an early time frame, and we can do the math and figure out when his birthday was. And then it just goes on to give information about who had been appointed his guardian for his father's estate. It gives that type of information. I'm going to go back to Cattaraugus County and see what else is here. And there are some minutes. Let's see. I'm going to just look at this one as an example, just to show you. You want to just check. Sometimes everything is in the big index, the general index. Sometimes everything isn't in there. So sometimes there are indexes at the front of the book too. So these are usually in alphabetical groupings. And then for this particular book, then it would tell you the page number to go in for this particular book. And the minutes would be something like, this is what happened in court. An administrator was appointed for this estate. And you know, these type of events took place with this estate. Next, I'm going to show you how to go in and find these records another way. So instead of going to that main database, another thing that you can do is go to the catalog. And you can look for the county. The probate records are going to be at the county level. I'm going to search for Niagara County. So here it is. And click search. And it will show you a list of the records by category. If you look at probate records, there's some different groupings, which some will be exactly what we just looked at. Sometimes there are things that aren't included in that bigger database. I'm going to click on the bottom one. And you can tell if it was included in that bigger database. When you see this red text, it's generally some sort of bigger database that leads you to the database. But sometimes I find, you know, if there's a really long list of items for a particular county, sometimes things are arranged a little bit differently than the other way. I like oftentimes they'll put the indexes right up at the top and they're not necessarily that way when you look the other way I just showed you. Sometimes just visually, this might be easier to look at. So you can see all of those records. And just be sure to look up here. Sometimes there are multiple pages of results. This only has one page, but you'll see right here, you know, page 1 of 3, page 1 of 4, whatever it is, so that you can forward through all the results. Going back to the search results, one thing that might be kept separate, or, you know, often see these kept separate, are guardianship records. So you want to look under the guardianship category and then see what's there and see how these aren't, there's no red text, there's nothing leading us to that other grouping. So these were not grouped in that other record set. So you do want to make sure that you look county by county for those records that may have been in a separate grouping. Okay. So that's everything I have on navigating probate Western New York probate records on Family Search. I do want to show you something quickly, and then we can get to questions. I did want to show you, let me see here. In case we do have a lot of upcoming programs happening for the Grosvenor Room, we do have a blog. There's an events tab, and you can see the other things that are coming up. Right now, they're all online, and you can see our list. We're going to have something on our digital collections, and we have a new collection that we added recently, so I'll talk about that. If you've seen that presentation before, I'm going to show something new. We're going to have a class on census records, anatomy of a U.S. military pension file for the Revolutionary War through the Civil War, getting the most out of Ancestry Library Edition. And then I'm going to do one, Government Secrets Revealed, County Supervisors Proceedings. A couple of other classes that were in the works for planning out in April is we got some suggestions from the Western New York Genealogical Society membership. Many people were interested in what railroad resources we might have. So that's going to be coming up in April, where we're going to have a staff member talk about our railroad resources. And I'm going to have someone from the Buffalo Irish Genealogical Society come and talk about their collection of New York Central Railroad employee records talk. And someone was interested in Masonic research. And there is a Masonic library in New York City, and we're going to have the librarian come and talk about doing research on your Mason ancestors. And then we'll have some more programs planned out for May and June in the summer. So I'm going to go ahead and stop the recording and stop sharing, and then we can answer any questions.